A lot of times, you know, you have to go along with some of these programs that you want. But let me tell y'all something too. This was in 1991. So I've been dealing with these people all the time. I'm the whole story. I know about the KKK thing. I know the whole thing. I know what time it is. I tell you what, you got to be very careful. Can't you imagine that go to the police department and you're going to stand for full of the KKK? Now, this ain't that what I think. See, I'm not saying that like a group. And what I'm saying, I'm a group. Now, what happened to me in 1991, Andy Hughes, y'all, said, now, he was a regular policeman at this time. They had about 100 police to come to arrest me. This time, they planted some dope woman. They had a raid down in the bar on black shit. Well, next to black shit. So I ran like everybody else was running when the police come. So as I was running, the police said, got a matchbox. Dope man. Larry Wyatt, this you. I'm running, I ain't running, but I'm running, you know, nothing to kill. Stay away from me. So I said, man, come on, man, don't do this to me, man. He said, this you, Mr. White. I said, man, come on, you got the kids up. They hit it on. They saw me down in the bar. Me and James Jackson were together. So what happened? They chased me. I got away. But somebody told them where I was at that night. What house I was in. So they came to the house I was in, knocked on the door. Boom, 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 boom. Y'all know what time it is when they do that. So I said, the police had somebody. I told them police where I'm at. So what happened is, I didn't know they had blocked off six blocks. Three one way, three the other way. I had a friend that said, they called me to go through. They're going to make sure that they catch Larry White tonight. And believe me, I'm to the room now. So what happened is, I jumped through the window. Boom! But before I jumped through the window, what I did was I took my shirt off. I took my shirt off to make sure they weren't killed. So when I jumped in the window, I started running. And Andy Hughes blocked me off. When he blocked me off, I threw my hands up. I said, I give. He said, yeah, man. He said, well, y'all know the time really is. He said, yeah, nigga, I know you did. When he swung on my head, I threw my hands up like this. So when he hit me, I fell to the ground immediately. Then about 20 of them started kicking and beating on me. I said, oh, y'all want to play like this? Y'all know I'm going to fight about it. So as he was kicking and beating, I tried to get up. Guess what, y'all? Y'all ain't going to believe it. These people don't knock my bone out my arm. And he's going to be knocking my bone. Now, but it's worse than that. When they knock my bone out my arm, I see a TV camera. So I'm telling the TV people what done happened to me, right? So anyway, they handcuffed me behind my back, y'all. Didn't even call an ambulance. Threw me in the back seat of the car. When they got me in the car, he had nothing like officer. I can't remember exactly what his name was. He said, well, you look, you got your arms up in time. I'm going to knock your damn head off over them damn bushes. And if you can believe, you want to laugh. So, but this happened recently, what I'm going to tell y'all now. Y'all ain't going to believe it. Well, yeah, I'm hoping you will. But what happened is, I came out of the house, and I walked up on them beating the guy named Chester. You know, they beating him and all. So when I see him beating Chester, naturally, what you think I'm going to do? I'll run. Ran right into the police. So somehow I ended up on the ground. So they handcuffed me behind my back, on my stomach on the ground. Y'all ain't gonna believe it. This one police officer ran up the well there and bam, drilled me in my head. So when he drilled me in my head, I don't want to act like I'm hurt. Because I'm scared they're gonna get me for resisting arrest and all that kind of stuff, right? So I don't say that. They take me to the jailhouse, I say, I feel like I'm gonna die. They took me to the hospital, right? They waited to take me back to jail after I get examined. That doctor said, any of y'all, they don't ain't gonna use y'all waiting on this guy because this guy got brain damage. I had blood all over my brain. They gave me an aneurysm. That don't bust my brain in there, that leave me so hard. So you know, I filed a lawsuit on that. I think I did it wrong, so I gotta see about that right there. But let's see. But one thing about it, let me tell y'all something. I've been arguing and fighting with these people for years and years and years. But you know one thing that I'm so happy of? And I'm just being straight. But see, God has revealed their sin. And it's not their regular sin. God has revealed their hidden. Come on now. God has revealed their hidden sin. And I was so happy when I found out about Andy. So I tell you, I can't believe it. But the one thing about it, I know that God answers prayer. See, a lot of times we can't see what God has, what God is going to do for us. You know, we get in a hurry. But let me tell y'all, I'm a witness that God answers prayer. I got to tell y'all this. Y'all ain't I mean, I got some me. I really have to go forever, but I'm going to get this show. Check this out. I was in jail. And a guy we put on the TV, and a lot of guys got mad at him. So I'm trying to keep guys from jumping on. We ain't jumping on the right guy. So the guy threw water in my face. Like, he don't know me. He don't know nothing about me. You know, but you know, he want to jump on, you know. When he threw the water in my face, I fell down. I slipped in the water, he threw in my face, hit me twice. Boom, boom. Put my head, put my head on my. Y'all know that ain't gonna work. Miss Zapp came in, she works there. So Miss Zapp came in and she said, who been fighting her? Who you been fighting? She said, somebody please me. So she left out. Bottom line is, and then the guy went back in my cell. I hit it. Not pretty hard. I was gonna beat him, but if I hit it, I broke the jaw and the neck. Now I didn't know that the neck was broken. I'm gonna try that. So they came to my cell, said, Eric, you're in trouble. They're supposed to hang you, but he got fighting for his life. Well, I had remorse for that. But what is so shocking about this case, y'all, is I get ready to go to trial. So when I get ready to go to trial, I wasn't worried about it because I really had no video. Then guess what they tell me, y'all? Ain't no video. Ain't no audio. You jump on that man, I kill him at the tape.
You kidding me?
To me, the DA and the private investigator done changed the story. This is a true story. This, I'm gonna tell you what. This lets you know that God is real. Now, the only person that can deliver me now is who? It's over. You got the DA and the investigator saying they're like to be the boy today. And that's a lie. But you know, get me first. So I go to trial. You know, I know I'm in trouble. Matter of fact, I get what they offer me, y'all. No, not here. Y'all, 1990. It's a Mr. White, we're going to get rid of you. We're going to make sure you don't mess with no more our officers ever again. We're going to put you away. But God, woo! But God, they don't pick the jury. I'm getting ready to go to trial. Talking to my lawyer. I said, talking to people. He said, Larry, I already told you that they got to have you. I said it again. Y'all, this is like a good God, y'all. The witness that I broke up, guess what he said? He said, I ain't trying to see that man for the rest of his life on jailhouse fight. Throw it together. Bam! Bye, God. Thank y'all. Remember I was telling y'all about a certain thing you can't talk about? This one of them.
Oh, you
don't. I go there. I'm going to talk about it. Check this out. Remember when I told you about the lean man's head? I'm going to tell you all that I see you before there. Check this out. Been on 2 years now. Ain't got it back yet. Ain't heard nothing about it. Oh, I don't get it back now. But what I'm saying is, y'all know y'all been paying before. See, and a lot of times, you know, we be afraid to mention things because we be afraid when it comes to start. Now, one thing about going to bed, I'll make consequences. So, you know, that's why you got to have proof, and you're not going to understand what they were saying about being able to prove what you say. But I want to wish you all good luck, and God bless you all.
It is amazing, but that's his story. Now, next we're going to ask Ms. Catherine Thomas. She is the mother of a young man who was killed here in 2012 by the Dothan police, an unarmed young man. You all, there's some seats in the choir stand. We're going to let your all follow up into the choir stand, our overflow. You can come around either side and come up to the choir stand, the ones who are still standing, the ones standing in the back. I'm calling up Ms. Catherine Thomas and Ms. Judy Malone. Ruby Malone. Again, I'll say, what do you know, Ms. Catherine Thomas? She's Chris Thomas' mother. And Chris, again, was shot by a policeman who was fired in Pensacola, Florida, had been out of policing for about 5 years. And he came over here and he was hired in Dothan. That's another thing, people. We got a lot of cops fired in one place and hired in Dothan. And that's something we need to look into. Mrs. Catherine Thomas and Mrs. Rudy Malone. Good morning. I ain't gonna be in here walking. But I want to share this with you. I want to share this with you. My son was killed in 2012. And I did have a chance to talk to the girl below. 2012, this is 2015. And I've been trying to get my son to long when he got killed. I haven't received him yet. But he got gave me a t-shirt, which is a woman blouse. He said he picked it up from out of the street in the park. And I'm just curious, what happened to his belongings? That's evidence, right? That's evidence. But they got to me, when they move, we don't know what happened. And I, and this side. You're right, and I ain't got.
Sam?
And he and I were both at his last city council commission meeting I went to. Both of us were just looked over on the time to speak. So we got a voice, and you have a voice.
My name is Sam Hughes. It's wonderful we're all coming together, no matter what race, color, corruption, this family. And it opened up the family.
Put Michael.
You hear that?
Yes.
I was a former firefighter in Dothan, Alabama, a good firefighter, actually.
Okay. That's right.
I'm not kidding. Anyway, I exposed a guy selling assault weapons on duty at fire station. Rather than fire the guy committing felonies, he went paying state, local, any taxes whatsoever, they persecuted me for 21 years. I've been arrested 20 times, I've been beaten 9 times, I've been handcuffed and pepper sprayed. I have proof that John White threatened to kill me and my family. 11 days later, they virtually did. Steve Parrish orchestrated me being followed 11 miles and beat up. They took me into the city of Oakland jail. Officer Beeson, Jay Coleman, questioned me about who Alfred was having an affair with. But my medical bills are around $111,000. I've been in the hospital 129 days, and my criminal record today is 17 wins, 0 losses, 3 innocent. But you mentioned we couldn't speak at the commission meeting. After that last commission meeting, you wouldn't let me speak. You banned me from going to the city of the commission chapter. I can't even go in that building. Who owns that
building? We
don't need it. But I'm represented by a lawyer, Judy McPhillips out of Montgomery, Alabama, who's put 3 Alabama votes. And so is Mr. Mark Ricardo. We have one of the best attorneys in the state, and we're going to get justice. But we have to work together no matter what color we are.
Okay.
I have those papers. There's a lot of bridges people in this community, but I'll tell you this, we all get ahead and we can be in a separate corner.
Yeah.
And you know, when I can tell you a lot about Ms. Carney's case without even getting involved. She may see attorney Lynn White mad at her for being honest. Okay? I know enough about her to know that she was honest about a lady that didn't need to drive. That lady made her kill somebody. Let me tell y'all why they fired me. You might be interested in this. I stopped at a wreck scene off duty. I'm a licensed EMT, certified to drive a fire truck in the state inspector. There was nobody with my medical training on that scene. The lady, Annie Mae Kennedy, is in the process of dying. They would not let me help her and make the motion to get back. That's all they were going to say. You know what happened to that poor lady? She died. She doesn't get a second chance. You know what happened in the case of Miss Carney? What happened to that lady? They backed somebody in the building and she eventually died. So there's two deaths if you're sort of over this. But for them, it's just game. You know? They don't care. It's all about convictions. Nevertheless, if he'll go after a poor black girl, still a gallon of milk. A fellow that sold 200 weapons. I've seen an AK-47 on the kitchen table at Westgate Fire Station. And I'll tell you this, we dig them up today. I watched a guy stand behind that fire station for a booty when he shoot guns in the ground. Where are those bullets at today? Behind the Westgate Fire Station. They know the truth, but they don't know the truth. But I'll tell you this close to the problem here. If you take and dig a huge hole here and you put the proof on it, what's going to happen the more and more you pile on them? When it comes out, what's going to happen? We just all know we got good Lord behind us and let's keep working together for better change. And we do have Arthur Medley, who may be the next district attorney who's been on the man. Thank you for letting me speak.
The next young lady is going to ask about is Mrs. Tanya Dorsey. She and I became familiar with one another a few years ago. She owned a food truck, and one of the repossession companies wanted to repo her food truck while she was conducting business. And it was outside of one of the local nightclubs. And according to city policy, once a tow truck driver comes to do a repossession, if it becomes confrontational, the tow truck driver must leave without what he or she came to get.
It's a piece.
So this is kind of what I encountered when I first met Ms. LaTonya. And I'm going to let her finish telling you some additional things that she encountered.
Hello, everyone.
Good morning.
My name is LaTonya Dorsey. And in 2009, I opened an account with Queen's Tech here in North Carolina because I was going to take these shirts right here, President Barack Obama, when he closed the inauguration in Washington, D.C. And I opened up the account and I paid a lump sum of money on that account. And then I got like a couple of months behind on the account. Then the next thing I know, the phone came knocking at the door, asked me would I go downtown. I said, okay. He said, I'm going to ask you something. I said, okay. So when I got down there, he was saying, well, look like you owe Spring Tech some money. I said, well, this is my accountant, man. So he said, let me go on the phone. I said, well, that's a big issue, sir. I can make a payment, you know. I can make a payment, you know, because I had a health issue. And he said, okay, let me make a phone call to Spring Tech. So he got on the phone call to Terry Collins, and he came back. He said, nah, he don't want your name. He wants to go to jail. But see, not knowing what was all behind and what's coming out now, the racial thing that's going on with the court, now I see why they arrested me. You can't arrest, it's just a law to arrest someone for a civil death. And that's what they did to me. But not knowing what they were doing, that it was a racial thing that was going on against Obama. It wasn't even about me being delinquent. Now, when my lawyer did the investigation, they had never arrested, a friend that had never arrested anyone before. Bama Jam owed them thousands and thousands of dollars. They were like 2 or 3 years behind. It was other companies that owed them like 5 years behind. It was one lady, she got a bad check of $1,200, and they never arrested her, and she never went and made it right to them. So I couldn't understand why they were charging me. It wasn't about me. It was about them thinking I'm supporting Obama. Mm-hmm. So back to the racial of what's going on. So once they arrested me, and then Doug Lester and Gary Maxwell, they chose a permanent white juror. So they told my lawyer before the case, they, well, these are our friends. And they're talking about the Spring Tech. It was the officer who was representing the Spring Tech company, Doug Lester, Gary Maxwell, Judge Bifford, all of them were connected. But so they said, the jury ended up finding me guilty because that's just the way they can't punish. So I kept, no matter how many lawyers I kept hiring, Judge Bifford wouldn't let me get my justice in court. So I got in touch with someone in Montgomery to find a lawyer on the outside. So I got in touch with the lawyer there. He came and got it overturned. Now, before that, you got it overturned, they put me in the room and said, listen, you better not fight me. You better not fight me. But they found that I was trying to fight it. They said, I tell you what. So they had sentenced me to 20 years probation, 20 years, suspended sentence, okay? All right, so when they found out that I was trying to fight it, they said, well, you've heard that you've been asking for Rule 32. So when they found out I was asking for Rule 32, they said, well, the judge wants to re-sentence you. I said, huh? I understand about, you know, an account being, you know, just being laid on an account. And so on my re-sentence, he put 10 years to attention. Yeah, 10 years to attention. Yeah, the judge was in on it, Judge Bifford, Doug Lester, Gary Maxwell, they were all friends, and I have proof of everything that I'm saying to you. But now that it came out about that they were so racial, now I know I was discriminated against because they felt like I was an Obama contributor, sponsor. Yeah, so I mean, it sort of go on and on. They've done a lot of bad things to me. So when I got the case overturned, I was on my way to Tuskegee to see a civil lawyer. They Cooper had got behind me. Said, ma'am, you driving too close to the truck. I said, okay, he said, ma'am, you can't step outside the car, you got a warrant to go arrest. I was in Bullock County. And I said, what girl? I said, look, I got paper. All that stuff. He said, damn, I don't know what they're doing over there, but you have another warrant on you. So my civil lawyer and my lawyer that I got from Montgomery, they're asking, can I bond out for Bullock County? And they said, no, we won't. We're telling you this. And I told them that in Bullock County, I said, something happens to me that I want y'all to know that they done something to me. So when that sheriff came over to Bullock County to get me, he was driving 95 miles per hour along the side of the road. Only after, sir, please, please slow down. He would not slow down. Somebody had dispatched him and said, are you okay? Yeah, I'm fine. And he kept driving past. The only thing that made him slow down, he saw another sheriff's car, then he followed. That's the only thing that made me slow down. So when I got to the county, then I was trying to report that, you know, he was driving fast, I just trying to scare me or whatever. But they done all kinds of tactics to me because I was fighting for myself. And no matter how it seems, everybody was telling me, fight. They asked me not to fight, but I was not fit to fight. I fought, and I got, you know, resolved. And I'm still fighting. So now that I found out that, you know, all this coming about, that's what's happening, and that's why. The police officer was saying, best friend of people on the screen, the double F was best friend. To the people that own the swimming pool. Jerry Spinford was best friend, you know, but they didn't expect me to fight. They thought I was just going to lay down and let them put their charge on me, you know, but then when I fought, it became bigger and a lot of people came involved. So they started doing tactics to scare me. They tried to have the county to deliver me to the civil papers at 12 something at night. The county, they had came in the house and drew down on me. And I said, what's wrong with you? I mean, because deliver me some civil papers. Y'all ever heard of the county trying to deliver me some civil papers at 12 o'clock at night? So, yeah. So he ended up coming drawing down on me with a gun, on me and my son. And I said, what's going on? He said, you got to sit by the third day, it's been resolved. And it had been resolved. So, and then I called the police on him. Because I said, sir, you know, you can get out of my house. He said, I don't have to go no damn where. So I made a report on that. So what they were doing was doing a different tactics to scare me because I was fighting them. So I'm just telling you, no matter what you go through, just keep fighting. Don't be scared. You can't be scared. Thank you.
Now, I just want to kind of piggyback on some of the things that the client spoke on. The manner in which law enforcement officers have been speaking to people, community members, people in the public, it's almost like their perception is you're a suspect right off the bat. No matter who calls or what you call for, you're not treated with respect. You're not treated with the dignity that you deserve just coming in the door. Each and every one of you should be greeted properly. You should be cursed out. I don't care what corner of the game you get into, whether you fought with them, or they had to fight with you and put you in the eye. I've arrested several people probably in the doors. I'm sorry. But I think Mr. Hector is one of the persons I believe I arrested, but kind of he aggravated me so much to the point where he made me complain one of the things. But by the time I got him to the jail, I offered him an apology and asked him to please accept my apology because that was inappropriate of me. And I didn't mean to go there with him. And sometimes I explained, you know, people will make you come out of your professional role so you can communicate with them. It's not that you're intending to do these things, you know, using profane language, at least not with me. So if I get pulled to that place where I have to address you, where you really understand me, that's the only time I go there. And again, even if I do, I still come back and I say, I apologize, I spoke to you that way. You know, I didn't mean that in any kind of negative sense. But at the same time, I was trying to do my job to get you to comply with what I was asking you to do. Now, I've witnessed other police officers who had absolutely no reason whatsoever to use that kind of language to persons they were dealing with. And I've gone so far as to call my supervisors and say, don't ever send me on another call with that officer again. Because I did not appreciate the way they spoke either to that person or how they were speaking in the presence of women or children. And I would excuse myself from being around it. And I would step outside. As long as I knew that officer had someone else there with him, he was coming and got back up for them, I excused myself. And I made it a point to call the supervisor and say, this is unacceptable. You could do something with this because you're the supervisor. I'm bringing it to your attention. Well, that doesn't get a brief. And quite frankly, if it's a white male officer, it never gets a brief. Officer Summers and I, this is kind of feeling it up for me. Officer Summers and I, when we first became aware of the Sons of Confederate Veterans and what Chief Parrish recently in a press release stated to the media that he created a charter of the Sons of Confederate Veterans in Henry County and that he recruited police officers to help him start that charter. He just said this on December 2nd, 2015, before local media. I don't care who you are, but I know, and I believe in my heart, that that is not an organization that supports the black community and is more for white supremacy than it is for having equal justice, equal anything for the citizens of this city. And in my opinion, and I would say this now, tomorrow, 25 years from now, he should not be a police chief. He should not have on a badge period. People are suffering behind that hatred. And that's all it is hatred and it's evil. It has no place in law enforcement. You can't equally apply the law when you have hatred in your heart for a person because of their color. There's no place for it. We all should be marching ourselves down there, standing in front of that police department, standing in the city commission office, saying no more. We do not want this person in office over this city. We shouldn't leave until that has been accomplished. We are opening ourselves up to allow this stuff to continue if we do not stand together and demand that they meet those expectations that we have as a community. I have listened to supervisors have conversations in the office next to me, complaining about Barack Obama being the new president of the United States. I'm in the office next door. No care, no concern. There's no way you're entitled to what you know you believe. If you support so and so, that's fine. No. I have memorabilia hung in my office. They moved my office from within the city police department, the main location, and changed a storage room at Wiregrass Community Center. That was a storage room for all the chairs and extra equipment for Wiregrass Community Park. They made it into the community services division. Guess who they put it there? Had no phone, had no internet, no computer, had absolutely nothing but a desk and a chair. That's it. Said, this is your new office. Why? Because I had Barack Obama's picture on my wall in the office inside the main building. I have pictures of that to show you. When people just pop up at my door, when I was in the police department's location, they just come to my office and just walk all around my desk, looking at stuff on my desk and on my wall. And I'm like, can I help you? These are supervisors, lieutenants, captains, secretaries. For what? I'm not out here saying you need to be with Obama because I am. I don't care what your preference is. That's your preference. There's no reason for you to take that what you believe and try to make it fit you. That's inappropriate. There's no place for that. But they're not going to tell you they did that for that reason. But that's what they do. These are things I've experienced and witnessed be done to other people. So off my trip on the top, and somebody left from the Miss Thatcher, Heather Thatcher. Now earlier I told you guys that this doesn't just affect black people. The majority of it affects black people, African Americans. But it also affects Caucasians as well. Especially when they feel you don't have the money, you don't have the contact, you're not friends with Doug, you're not friends with the mayor, you're not friends with the commissioners, you're not friends with these businessmen that own these businesses around here that pay for everything. So it doesn't just affect us, but it does affect our community more than it affects some of the other groups. So I'm going to let this pastor hear her
story. I'm a little nervous because I don't want to do something like this. Last year, I was going to the veteran cash and trying to get my cash and license and an officer left me. And an officer decided to go behind me. And follow this to the bank, so instead of doing my regular routine, you could stop. Instead of doing a regular routine stop, it's barricaded us like we were doing something wrong, and we put his foot in the car, which my brother's car. He pulled my foot at the time out of the car, and next thing I know, we had a phone narcotics stay behind us. Had my car open like it was a body shop. I kept asking, next thing I know, my car was there, so I was getting out of my car. 3 seconds later, the man pulled out his paper, smelled it, and couldn't figure out what he was smelling, but yet I did not see what he had in his hand or what he showed. We wouldn't tell him each other because he didn't know where the stuff came from or even what it was to say anything, so they arrested us, and so now I'm going to fix. And I'm kind of scared because I've never been in trouble before, and I don't know, I tried to turn to people to see what I could do, and so I'm just scared to go to court with a felony hanging over my head and giving me a record. We kind of make this mic so everybody can hear what we're saying. For Miss Thatcher's sake, I spoke to her when the paper came up. Quite honestly, what happened with her was more what normally happens to us. Police profiling is what happens. A black male and a white woman. Yeah. Need I say anything else?
Excuse me, I was the one in the call. I have a extensive drug history, but I paid my debt aside. I go to work every day. I'm on my way in 30 minutes. But I had to come here because I wanted to get off the chest. Me and my lady, we was she picked me up in my house, I was cutting grass. She asked me to ride her to the bank, get a cash check, go get a car check. So we had 3 days and we made the sign. So as we were going to the bank, the police passed me. He whips around in the road. I mean, very erratic. He gets behind us, and I'm where the stop sign. I make a left into the back. When I make a left into the back, he comes in behind me, jumps out. He pulls the car and barricades off, and he jumps out and he says, why are you trying to elude? And I said, I'm not. I was just getting out your way. I don't know where you were going or what you were doing. But I was going to the bank. So he said, well, I smell raw marijuana. So I said, sir, he said, I stopped you because you ain't got a tag on your car. So she pulls out the tag and said, we've had a car 3 days. He said, I don't want to see that. I smell raw marijuana in the car. I said, sir, I don't know why you smoke no marijuana. He tells me to get out the car. I get out the car, he searches me, he puts me in the backseat of the other car, the police car. So from then on, I really don't know what happened because they kept me in the car the whole time. They never showed us what they found in the car, which they said they did after all these narcotics officers that got there over tagged. They never wanted to see the paper for it. So when he finds out that we purchased the car, he says, well, I thought it was a rental car and you picked her up. Now, I've never told him it's my girlfriend. So, I guess a week later, we're laying in the bed, and the police called, and they asked her, I know he was in the car with his guy. Now, he has an extensive drug history, and all we need you to do is tell us that it's his, and we'll let you go, and we're going to charge him. Now, I'm laying in the bed listening to the whole conversation. When she tells them I'm laying in the bed listening to this, they hang up. They haven't contacted us in a year and a half. We haven't heard anything, nothing. And I just want to say, everybody know why they pulled us over. We know why they pulled us over. We went down and wrote complaints. We both went down and went through a legal action. We asked for complaints. They gave us to it. We went home. We filled it out exactly what happened to her either. They told us that it was inconclusive. They don't see nothing the officer did wrong. And like I told them, y'all searched this car twice and didn't find it. Now all the narcotics officers get here, and y'all say y'all find something in a little. All I know, it was little and it was square. And they say it was under the driver's seat, the passenger seat of the car. And like I told them, well, if it was under the passenger seat in the first place, it ain't my vehicle, and I was in the driver's seat. Why did I even go? If anything, y'all should have took her. They said, because she doesn't have a record, she's never been in no trouble. We can't make it stick to her, but we can make it stick to you. When they said that, I didn't say nothing else. They're going to take me to jail, man. Take me to jail before y'all do something to me. They called her every time crackhead, excuse the language. But they called her every time, and she's never been in no trouble in her life. They never had a case, they never nothing. But they called her all this. And they called me everything out of my name. I didn't never say nothing to them. I just let them say what they had to say. The only thing I said was, just take me on to the county jail, man. Take me on and let me go and make my bond. But I just want to share that with y'all. Because I really feel like she didn't tell it right. I told her I wasn't going to come up here. Thank y'all for letting me share my story. And I wish I could really stay in here. Everybody else, but I got to go to work, y'all. I'm very sorry, but thank you for hearing my story.
Now, I haven't had the opportunity to do this, but before you all leave, we have a legal team that came down and offered their services to assist Ms. Davis with filing the necessary motion to get her son released from prison. And as I stated earlier, they want to take your name. For everyone who wants to file a complaint, you have to file an affidavit. And they're going to take those affidavits and work for us to get what we're trying to get accomplished. And I'm going to have this young man come up and speak to you just after two more people. Mr. Baker? He don't need no introduction.
Good morning. I heard one of the speakers say that this sanctuary area will be saved if she's staying here. But I want y'all to know when I came, I saw the big stoves across the street taking pictures of everybody that came in. So it's not just like the illegal scent. I don't see it in the void. So I don't know why he's out there taking pictures of them to scare us in his art. But I came on my own. Some of you know that I'm Keith Gray's brother. And I didn't come to speak for him. I came to speak about him.
That's all right.
Okay. I want to say that Dublin City officials, including the mayor, the city manager, the EEO officer, the personnel directors, and most of the commissioners, and some people of color, we call them leaders. I say they can't leave Stevie Wonder to the bathroom. without asking the mayor of the Mercedes leadership, can we take him to the bathroom? Now, some of them have seen these pictures, most of them, all of them, have seen these pictures of Andy Hughes and the Ku Klux Klan, I should say, Sons of Confederacy. They've seen those pictures before because when we first had an organization meeting, some of them were hit in my backyard in the man cave. We passed out these pictures of that Confederate flag with all these officers there. And they knew and still know, and not just now, getting the information like you are, they've been knowing. These leaders have been knowing that racism was in the midst of the Duncan Police Department. I wrote down some notes because when I speak, sometimes I get angry. Sometimes I might even cry. Then I get ready to fight. I was one of the few individuals that was at the depositions of the city of Dothan when they were being deposed by the attorneys of Keith Gray. And I heard the police chief, when he admitted, and let me tell y'all something, not only is Ricky Stokes out there, there's other folks in here that's going to run straight back to the commission. But anyway, I was at the deposition. I don't know if they wanted me to be there or not. I'm sure they did. But I was sitting right there and I heard all of the testimony against my brother. And I heard them admit that all of that stuff they accused him of was not true, that it did not happen. I even heard the police chief when he said that he had committed a crime. When he said he had guilty of adultery, and that is a crime, he admitted that under oath when he was deposed. He was being dishonest with the citizens of Dothan, Alabama by doing that, and yet still he rose and fired my brother for being dishonest. That just doesn't sound right to me. Chief Parrish, he's admitted that he organized and is the grand coupon, if it's such a word, of the Sons of Confederacy. He even named his son after the founder of the Ku Klux Klan. That's Nathan Bedford Forrest. And that's what he named his son. Now, who don't think that he's a member of the racist KKK? He named his son, his only son, I do believe, after the founder of the KKK. And yet still, some of you all and have said that Parrish is okay. And I'm gonna leave with this. Now y'all may say that, but what I say is that parish must go.
Right.
Y'all say that with me.
And Mr. Cynthia, the motion, we call for who else to go? I want to say all hate group members, anyone who pledges allegiance to another flag, because we're Americans, we have every right and every duty ever trained. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. One nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We do not pay people who pledge allegiance to the Confederate flag or any other things that are not the American flag in our right there and here. That gives us our right. God bless y'all. I think Ramonica is going to come up now. I'm coming at forms. Anybody else who needs forms, raise your hand. Anyone who has forms, who want to share them, that aren't going to need them, share them. We're printing 100.
We did not have any more of the printed copies of this form. All we're asking you to do is to print your name, your address, your email, if you have one, your phone number, and a brief synopsis of what your concerns and questions are. And then sign it and date it with today's date. I'm going to call my cousin up, Mr. Holyfield. This site is actually streaming live on YouTube, and all you have to do is Google Justice in Dothan Now. Justice in Dothan Now on YouTube is where this is live streaming. This is Horatio Holyfield.
I'm the better looking cousin. But there was a guy that came up and said that they were pulled over because they didn't have a tag on the car. It happened to me one morning on my way to work at a four-way stop there on Range Street. And the cop pulled me over, and he pulled me over, and he said, "Good morning." I said, "Hi." He said, "Did you purchase this new car?" I was like, "Look, I work 5 days a week. Sure, I did. I'm driving, right? Work uniform on, everything." I said, "Can I help you?" He said, "I need you to step out of the car." I said, "Fine, no problem." When I stepped out the car, I asked him, I said, "Do you want a registration, insurance, everything?" He said, "I'll get you that later." Well, he went back to his car. About 5 minutes, he come back with a license in his hand. "Now, you still want the registration and everything?" He showed up for his car. He said, "No, but you have a good day." Okay. But, you know, it's everywhere. It's not just here. Please understand. Because one of my reasons for coming here is this young lady is obituary. My 2-year-old granddaughter that was beat to death by my daughter's boyfriend. Now, they live in Louisiana. And when all was said and done, my daughter was at work. They have a copy of videotape. They have written statements from her supervisor. My daughter was charged with 20, she was sentenced to 25 years. And she was never even at home. But the guy that beat my granddaughter to death, he got 5 years with 2 years suspension. Why? He's from out there. He was born and raised out there in a little parish in Louisiana. So everybody knows everybody. And I cannot get anyone. I have written letters, I have emailed people, I can fact. I cannot get anybody to give me any help with this thing. And the first thing that I have contacted one person, the first thing come out their mouth is $50,000.
Yeah.
And don't even know the case.
Yeah.
Because they know that I don't have that kind of money. But see, we as black people, we have a tendency, and my granddaddy used to say, bump our gums when we're together. But when we go outside, we see it over my mind. We can come in and tell everybody everything that's going on. Oh, I wouldn't be bothered with that. So it's available to you to make a statement where somebody can hear and somebody that you may be able to help and that may be able to help you. If somebody stepped on your toes, you wouldn't say that. And we as a people have to get over it. We have been persecuted for years and years and years. But now that we have a voice, like WTBY and radio stations and what Raymond has been doing, this is where it began. And we cannot let this fall on deaf ears. Because as long as we fall on let it fall on deaf ears, we going back to the day of slavery. I don't know about you, but the only master I know is
I hope you guys are really paying attention to some of the common themes that connect us. The common themes, racial profiling, racism, false charges, these are the common things. We're low income. We don't have $10,000 to put up to make an attorney take our case, and then he don't represent you when he does get your money. These are what we're bringing attention to, and we're trying to get all of that to stop. Our next, Ms. Jolly, Laura Jolly.
How y'all doing?
What?
I don't stand up and not come to Wyatt. There you go. You killed me on TV. Okay, what happened? I was going to stay passionate, not know what this is. This has been going on since I moved to Dalton in that court.
That's right.
If anybody know what this thing that happened over there at the bottom, where the drug test was running from the ground, almost hitting the floor over there, and contact the speaker, that was me. The guy, they were chasing me, supposed to be chasing me, right? He was walking to the back corner. Now, you walking, but you got all the flying through the glass, and I thought it was hot. And my child, that pinned you almost hit my child. And then, after that, he got to come. I was talking to my neighbor, and my God says, more friends than I said, this man almost hit my child. He won't do nothing like that. What you say? I said, I wasn't talking to you anyway. It was gunfire. He stood in my door. He said, tell you what? We help with the niggas around here. I said, you got the right nigga now. Come and see me, he come back here. He said, what did he tell you? We messing with niggas in the bottom. I said, I'm not from the bottom, first of all. And I'm not your nigga. I told him, I had my hand, they tell him I come in. I said, wait a minute. I said, where are you taking on anyway? We kept on pushing to the ground. Lord, shoot me, got up. I got up. Him and Steve Parrish said, whatever they say, okay, let's go on with it. I got on the floor. I said, before we get to doing whatever y'all want to do. So some of these niggas. I told my friend, I said, call my mama, come and pick. So I called my mama. I said, Mama, I'm going down, but I'm going to the right way. I said, cause I'm going to take the bread bag and going to call me and look at and come out, they run the bottom. First of all, I just was down here for a chicken white rock in the bottom. Okay, got my mama on the phone, she knows what's going on, she got to get it together. I had 6 cans of mace. Then he passed him, Gonzalez, when the old one. Baby Weaver said, I thought I got him on the ground and hit me. I said, come on, let's do it. They called 4 or 5 more others, and everybody over here kind of black people we don't play. And when they got on the down there, they called me back. I heard them call me. But this nigga finna go off. I said, well, throw my hands up. I said, if you want to kill me, they already know. But justice is gonna prevail.
Yeah.
But you ain't got no rights on this ground, flying what you call. This guy walking. I don't know what all they planted on him. I don't know what all they took the money off of him, whatever he got. But I have seen him. And my face over there, my way home. Come back, take the money off your black guys. Where you working at? Ain't got a job. We gonna go around the corner and split this up. That's what we reported downtown. And I told them, I don't care what they charge me with, this is my money. I could make cash money all day. You ain't got no business with no money in your pocket. And all y'all that say Steve Parrish ain't go, that was 94. He got to go. And I said, if I was in Houston County at the time, y'all see the whole community. We went to the city manager with a talk from head up. I got a thing to talk, but I ain't worried about it. You can't stop with what I'm saying. So that's all I got to say.
Y'all can't hear the passion in her voice.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not just talk. That's from the heart. It's from my heart. It's from Keith Gray's heart. It's from Miss Baby's heart. It's from Miss Thomas' heart. It's from everybody in this room that has something to say.
Yeah.
Now, I mentioned that Miss Davis had a team to come together to assist her with filing a motion yesterday in federal court to demand the release of her son for violation of his constitutional rights. And I'm going to let Mr. Larry Eden come forward and speak to you. One of the things we talked about amongst us was finding people in the community to represent us in these positions of power in the city of Dothan. When we have people who are educated and can do these jobs, those are the people we need to stand behind and push to get in these offices. Just complaining and saying we want somebody out, we need somebody to put in there. So we don't need to go in there blind and just throwing words around. We got somebody that's fully qualified. Fully qualified, if you ask me, to be the police chief. They found every single way they could to try to disqualify him. Not once, twice. But they won't put him in office. And with me, I was up for sergeant. They tampered with that thing. Then they charged me with false charges. Any black person, I'm telling it like it is. I don't care if you like it or don't like it. Any African American, I would have been the first black female sergeant in the department. And I don't even know how many years I've been in the prison. I don't do wrong to people. I can communicate with anybody. I can work with anybody. And I don't like the way my name and the 17 years I've been in law enforcement has been reduced to shame, humiliation, constant, you know, stuff in the media to try to paint a certain type of picture of me. Well, I tell you what, I know I got a lot of good friends in this room because every time people see me, they always say, hey, Officer Carney, how you doing? It's good to see you. I'm glad you stood up for yourself. We support you. We support you. And I tell you, I thank you from the bottom of my heart. I thank each and every one of you for always encouraging me. Because it's been rough. It has been rough. So I'm going to let Mr. Larry Eden come up. Because Mr. Eden is also running for president. Okay. And in addition to him, I'm going to let this young lady take the floor.
Praise the Lord.
The United States of America.
Good is evil.
Good afternoon, good morning, whatever. Listen, I really don't need a microphone, but I want you to hear me and hear me well. I stand here today for two reasons. First of all, for you all, I'm your president for the state of Alabama, New Order, National Human Rights Organization. My name is Angela Spann. I'm right here at Enterprise, Alabama. You can knock on my door, whatever you need to do, do it. Grocery store don't matter. I don't have no off day. Second thing, I stand here today for a cause for my daughter. My daughter is a young lady that was sentenced to 235 years here in Dothan, Alabama. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
You see me on the news, I'm going to stay on the news, okay? I don't have no fear in me. I'm going to introduce you all when I tell a little bit about how my daughter came to this 235 years here in Dothan. My cousin, Mary Johnson, ex-police officer and magistrate, Mr. Larry Ely, these people were here for me. And that's how Mr. Ely is going to be here for you. He is who he say he is. Now, I'm going to tell you something. If I had my way, I'd tell you get on that side of the road and I'd stand here, let's do it. My cousin Mary and Mr. Ely will beat you down with some legal paperwork. So you in the right hand. Believe me when I tell you, everything don't have to be paid for. Okay? Here we go. You in the right hand. You're not afraid. Why have they been crazy? I hope this man's been arrested. My cousin's been arrested. They tampered with them all the way in Atlanta, Georgia. We're here today, though. So you run and tell everything else, tell him. Hear me well. You got leaders that will send you straight to hell. Okay? One is King Glasgow. Run, hunt, hell. Okay? Tell him I said it. I told him myself. You will never stand in another courtroom with me, beside me. And that's Mary. He was married to Mary's niece. And you're no good. Hear me well. He is taking money from you all and is a 501c nonprofit organization. He's not supposed to take one dime from you all for him to help with your cases. 7 years ago, he put on a rally for me and Officer Kearney. It was like, You tell me one person can win a basketball game by themselves. You go to hell by yourself. This same man, Glasgow, served 14 years in prison at the hands of Houston County. Why would you even befriend any of them? In the courtroom for 4 days until I put you out on that third day. I put you out of the courtroom on the third day when it came to my child. You're in the courtroom disrupting with your cell phone. That's Colonel. That general. Oh, I didn't take this call. Rude. Do your mama Tina kitchen. I'm not hungry. I get food stamps. You are the perfect man. With his wrong door. He is the enemy. Hear me when I say this now. He is your enemy. I started off in his organization, but it didn't take me long to realize
When you get stopped by the police, they got a minute or two before they get out the car. Turn your cell phone recorder on. Put it on the floorboard. On the seat of something. If you're mad that you don't have a visual audio, a visual, get that voice. And when you be intelligent about it, what's going on today, officer? Bullwinkle. Say his name. Say his name. He ain't gonna like it, but that's your right. This day was coming. If you look back in the news 7 years ago, I said, Genesis 37:17 meant more to me than the time they gave my daughter on 9/11, the sentence, where it said, let us go unto Joseph. So you gonna tell me God didn't have Barack Obama already in the plan? You gonna tell me today what's not gonna happen today? Because y'all finally got fed up. Where it took a woman whose son has been locked away for 9 years for something he hasn't done, hasn't been accused, he's been falsely accused of, no evidence of nothing. I go every month to see a child in prison 7 years for something she didn't do. Who gets 235 years? You don't live 235 years. What are you saying? What I did say this. You got the wrong child, but you got the right mom.
Get it!
Judge Anderson is the judge giving the most sentencing to anybody in Dothan and anywhere else than any other judge. That says something. $28,000 is what I spent for attorneys the first time around. This was for Jim Portland Law Firm. Supposed to be a bad boy for a DA. But y'all got in the courtroom and played with my daughter's case to be on sentence and have nerve to ask for $10,000. You got fired. You're not dividing no more than $10 a month up among you people. Let me say this. Another thing. You don't see these lawyers, judges, or none of this eating with you at Ryan's, do you? They at the country club having their meetings. They know how the case is going to be when they're, before you even get in the courtroom. Why are you putting money in their pockets? Why are you putting money in the pockets of lawyers in your community? Get on the phone and call that 800 number at Loud Burn Hell. Get somebody that don't have no time down here. Are you understanding what I'm saying? I care what the reputation of them is or was. They done sold their souls to the devil. And when you say it, somebody gonna tell it. I said, don't say it. Tell it. I said, 15-1 night together, knock it out, crack in their body. If you look at your history, it was not a white man. Excuse me, my white brothers that are here that are for the right reason, but if you're not, you go tell me. There was not a white man chasing us down in Africa. You need to watch Ruth. They sent another black tribe to turn their own people. Why? He sat on the bank with his liquor bottle. Did he not? That's the same thing going on today. Instead of you all sticking together, you run and tell them what they need to know. They ain't got to work for it. You may not approve of something that is wrong, but somebody talks to what else? Make them do that job. It's not for you to snitch. Make it for you to do what? They're going to feed you to the same wall to be on my face. You should be tired. Get mad. You know why you're being targeted? You don't have the money they got. It has nothing to do with your skin color, white man. You got too much black soul in you. That's the problem. I'm not a prejudiced person. But you got to be real about what you're saying you're doing. Black soul is the avatar. This bird went from him. Don't give him no money either. He's sleeping. That people still watch the video. His name is Dick Craig. He's nothing to me. Tell him I say, Angela Spain.
I think the point that's trying to be made, though, behind that
is, as you know, Wynn Street is in the black neighborhood. So likely chances are that it's someone of African American descent. But I don't know all the details. So we don't know. We'll wait till the movie come out. Another one of the members of with Mr. Ely is Miss Mary Johnson off the legal team. We're gonna have her also come up and speak.
Good afternoon. Are you guys sick and tired of being sick and tired? Well, I hope you are. My name is Mary Johnson. I am an ex-magistrate. I work in this court, and I am an ex-police officer as well. This is my partner, Mr. Larry Ely, the one that is running for presidency. But let's deal with the issue at hand. Mrs. Davis, well, as a matter of fact, I reached out because we are ACLG, we're out of Atlanta, and what we do is we reach out to people within our community because we understand that we all can afford to get attorneys, okay? Now, what we really have got to understand too, and I'm not gonna stay too long, I want you to hear this, each and every one of you. You go to an attorney, and the attorney works for the state, the prosecutor works for the state, the judges work for the state. Now, the first thing that you should mention going in, you should say state on the record, okay? And you have to always remind these people sometimes that this is a conflict of interest. How can you have my interest at heart when, I mean, when you all are getting paid by the state? So what I'm trying to tell you is they do not work for the people. Please understand that. And what we know is they do work for the crown. Now that might sound a little out of order to you guys, but we do know that they work for the crown. See, the British are taking over our country day by day. And we're walking around none the wiser, and you think, and let's just go back for a minute to what Mrs. Fan said, Tiana's mother. She said when she went to the court here, the judge stated that they did not believe in constitutional rights. There was no constitution here. They were not part of the constitution. Well, let me help you understand what that judge meant that day. When you all walk into a courtroom and you see that flag in there with the yellow fringes around it, baby, that is not our flag. We are governed under military rule, okay? So first of all, let me tell you this. Our people are locked up because they voluntarily, okay, they voluntarily sign on the dotted line. We know that this is a commercial court. Administrative court is totally illegal in every sense. The only thing our courts are supposed to be dealing with under that flag is pretty much commercial issues, contract. If you do not sign on the dotted line, you should be able to walk home. Nobody, who gives them the right to think that they are over you? My rights come from God. I'm under 10 commandments and over God's 10 commandments, not man's commandments, okay? So we've got to start doing some research, people. We have got to wake up and stick together as God's 12 tribes, okay? Now, what I do believe, what we do know, is God is waking up his people across this land, across this nation. Now, whatever goes on, I want all of us to begin to say, like Mr. Fan mentioned earlier, that we have got, if the legislature is acting out of order, if the judges are acting out of order, go and pull their oath of office, okay? I have 5 oath of office pulled. Sometimes we got to remind these judges that they are judges, and they are supposed, when they swore in under the Constitution of the United States. Now, we have got to make them hold up to their oath of office. We will go into the courtroom, which they hate us everywhere we go because we are paper pushers. We don't talk. We file paperwork. Now, if you want to scare some of them, you start filing paperwork.
That's right.
Okay? Now, you can talk all day long, but if it's not on record, they don't give a damn. So what I'm telling you is we have got to stand together and we have got to start filing paperwork for like we're supposed to. Now, Mrs. Davis, we got in touch with her. I absolutely called Mrs. Davis. She's a beautiful person. And she told me the story about her son. And she told me how he had been locked in the county for 9 years. Now, my heart goes out to each and every family, not one, not two, but each and every family, because those are my children. Okay? We are ITAV. We have an organization called ITAV, it takes a village, and also FCLG. We are about the community, okay? We have to be about the community, okay? You people, we need to rise up and work together. What we do understand is Doug Velasquez, Doug Velasco, or whatever he want to call himself, we want him gone. We want a few of these strong people to stand up, and let me tell you what we need to do. While we're here, we're going to be here until Monday, Tuesday, okay. We have a few more meetings, but this is what I want you guys to do. We brought complaint form. What I want you to understand is what these people are doing is criminal.
Right.
They are criminals.
Yes, ma'am.
So we want to file affidavits on these criminals. We want to charge the child against them. Each and every one of you young men and women that have a story, we need to file affidavits. That's a powerful, powerful tool. Okay? Even if you go to court for anything, you file your affidavit. Nobody can dispute your truth. Understand that. Now, I am not going to hold you guys any longer, but what I do want to say is, let me say this before I leave. I made some people mad saying this. I was at the sheriff's department, and I think they wanted to run me out. We did hear later on that they came over to see if we were going to be back at another meeting. Now, let me just say this for all of you out there that probably haven't stopped, and they told you that you needed a driver's license. Well, the Supreme Court has ruled that no man, unless they can produce a 990, should have or need a driver's license. Driver's license, they were used for people that were driving a buggy, a golf cart, you know, the horse. That's what you needed a driver's license for. Now, if you have any cases pending in reference to your driver's license being suspended or that you don't have a driver's license, you need to look up the Supreme Court case on no driver's license, and you need to file a motion or you call up. Okay, and we need to get this paperwork filed, okay, so that we can have these charges. But anyway, I'm going to hand it over to my partner. Let me please say this. We cannot be in 5 and 6 places at one time. So we do have a black book, is what we call it. We have several of these. We do the research for you guys. So what I'm saying is, this book right here is 62 ways and more, a whole lot of more information that you can vacate any charge. Things that they don't want you to know.
Knowledge.
But guess what?
Knowledge.
We have the secret. Okay? And it's no secret anymore. All right? So, you can call for our Facebook page. We will give you our number. You know, we'll leave our number here if you need to get in touch with us. We will be on the radio station in Montgomery if you would like to listen to us. But I'm going to let Mr. Ely talk about the case. I didn't hit the case. I'm going to let Mr. Ely talk about that case, okay? So I would just like to say we would love to have you guys support. We need to march downtown Dothan, and we need to file criminal charges on the judges, the prosecutors, and the officers.
Your meat thing, Glasgow just got word that you and I
was talking bad about him.
Oh, oh,
no,
no,
no, no. I got to break it off.
I'm gonna have
to. I got to have the message. I didn't call him at all.
We don't want to focus on that tattoo, but we got for y'all rules and reigns. He rules and he reigns. He reigns. You understand me?
I will take down any DA, any police, and any federal judge.
Bring them on. They will not meet me in a court of common law jurisdiction. We got sued here, Donald Valenza. But Valenza, y'all know him? We got sued J. Kevin Moe. Who was that? And we got sued Douglas A. Valesta. Now, we call him for the ouster of your police chief. We call him for the ouster of the mayor. By the time that you do it, you will know how to write. You will understand the law on the criminal side. My campaign running against the prison system. I'm plucking people out of jail across the country. I'm swinging my in-game. Do you know that each defendant gets 3 days per day that they sit in jail under RC 2945-0171? Mandatory! If you've got to be in court in 180 days, it's cut to 90 days. And if they don't take you to court, you file a piece of toilet paper. 2945-71 has just a click, and they better come and get you, or you call the FBI on the spot. They're going to say, y'all got to let him go. They're going to say, why? We get money off of his incarceration. $200 a day, y'all. Okay, so you got a $10,000 fine. You in jail. $200 a day. Most of the people sitting in jail, fines already paid in full. When the court see me coming, they said, we got to kill this nigga. Because I'm coming in with your bond, with your UCC filing, I can put a lien on anybody. Let somebody cross my path, I'll destroy their household. And the police across America know I'm coming. They said, we got to shoot this nigga in one of these rocks. I got to do it. All that I got is a UCC filing. You don't need a gun, Thomas, black man. Don't you know that the black man owned this country? Alabama is the longest running slave state in U.S. history. Now, I ran for governor of Ohio last year. They had put me in jail for obstruction of official business of a police. That's a rally one day. March 1st, no, April 1st, 2013, never forget, surrounded by undercover police. Put me in jail. I'm laying in there, I'm like, man, I've been kidnapped. I know how I feel now, so God said, get up. I get up out of the bed, looked around all the prisoners. I knew most of them said, hey, what you doing in jail? It was going crazy. I said, all right, so we finna riot. I filed 57 motions, 13 writs of habeas corpus. I filed a mandamus directing the judge to dismiss these cases. There was a blind white man in jail, been in there for 6 months. A black man with one leg in the wheelchair said, Mr. Eden, can you get this man out of here? He was gone the next day. All the prisoners that could not read and write, we had class every day. I said, I don't know how long I'm going to be here, y'all, but we going to write. We going to write. You going to write your ass out of here. You ain't going to sit around in jail and kill time. I got stopped going to Virginia. Highway 68 coming through Maryland got pulled off. 57 white police with shotguns. Since you got a pound of heroin in your rental car. Them crazy mothers took me to the mountains. I said, where in the hell am I? Caucus Hills. And I was only the one of three black guys in jail. I got up and looked, it was all white guys. From Washington, Virginia, West Virginia, couldn't even read or write. They said, we're from the hills. Can you help us? We had class in there every day. And when I was leaving, when they said, Mr. Ely, you free to go, I said, well, I just subpoenaed then Governor John Casey, and he gonna meet me down there. You said, I'm charged with heroin. They threw that out. Then they said I didn't have a driver's license. They threw that out. Because the Supreme Court said, unless you're making money along the public highway, you don't need an operating license. If you convert, see, it's the mind thing. If you take your regular automobile and begin making money with it, that is under the UCC 15. You're making money along the public highway. In 1803, the Supreme Court stated, no one shall encroach on your civil and constitutional rights. You own the police. You own the judge as a magistrate to hear your case. Say, Your Honor, somebody took something from me. Can you get it back? And that's it. That's all. When you call the police, he's there to serve you. Get my cat out of the tree. Somebody hit my car. I need a report for my insurance company. Have a good day. What's going on here? All these police shooting people. Now, the first police on my hit list is the police that killed Michael Brown. I'm giving him life in prison.
Yeah.
We're looking at massive criminals. They are acting as agents. The Supreme Court of the United States abolished the 1866 Civil Rights Act, October 13, 2013. I said, what does that mean?
What?
So that means the 1965 Civil Rights Act is gone. Title 42 USCA is gone. 42 USCA 14141 is gone. That's the Rodney King Accountability Act, where you can sue a police officer from 40 years back. Now, did y'all know that? All you gotta do, that statute of limitations under Callahan versus State, you can reopen any case. Did you know that?
Wow.
If you was assaulted 30 years ago, you can file your case to the Attorney General under the Rodney King Accountability Act. The Fifth Amendment and 14th Amendment has no statute of limitations. You start your claims out with a UCC-1 filing against the party who hurt you. You don't file a lawsuit in court. You send them a notice of claim between you and the individual registering postal mail. Say a police officer run you over. You send him a claim. He got 20 days to answer. If he disregards the claim, the postal service is the highest service on the sea and land. Did you know that?
Yeah.
The postal service is over any court. When the postman is delivering your claim to the police, they better not touch it. He's gonna say, you got a certified letter. Could you sign this? You gonna be like, do I gotta sign this? I'm gonna say, you better sign it. Because if you refuse, that's prima facie case of fraud against a public official. And that's your case mounted up. Then you send your second notice, which is a 10-day notice. You ain't went to court yet. You don't need no lawyer. You need no court. Because the court, the lawyers work for the police. They work for the British. The British are here. They look white, but they're not. I can see British police posing as white people. So when I get into court, I say, can I see your birth certificate? Do you have a social security number? I got 30 questions for each police officer under a motion to suppress. That's the trial before trial. And if the judge denies the motion to suppress, you file an interlocutory appeal to the Court of Appeals and have them removed. You gotta know the steps with this thing. And all y'all young drug dealers out here, I'm coming straight to you. You crack dealers. You heroin dealers. Let me tell you something. The U.S. Army just brought in here $1 trillion in drugs.
all just for the black community. But guess what? This is a special badge. Woo! They did research on white duck fans. They said, guess what? How we're going to get rid of these things? We're going to lace this new drug with an amphetamine that's going to hook the white people. It's going to hook them and lead to the death. Then guess what? You get a knock at the door. You catch on surveillance selling crap. This particular person that died, can you come with us, sir? And you ain't going to see the streets again. So I'm telling these little crack dealers that y'all making money, that money is dirty. It's already been in circulation. It's no good. I talked to crack dealers in jail all the time. I said, brother, what you sold ain't even real. What you killed for had no substance. Do you know that President Obama and Congress is sending $30 billion a month to Israel? The money for the lead. Haven't y'all noticed something? Money, yeah, I'm making no money. And then watch it. Is it just about ready? The King Alpha plan? Yes. Get ready for the military because black people going to revolt. But this revolt here going to be different. Y'all better see the emergence of 10, 20, 30, 40, 60 million black people coming from the West. All called by God. And all the black people who oppose the civil rights movements, you're going to know who they are, man. See, when the money leaves, everything comes loose. You're going to see who was who. The people you thought was bad to the bone. Where my friend at? He's gone. Here come the police already. Somebody going to be sitting there that you didn't think was going to be there. Hey, I heard about you, but you standing with me? And it's going to be some white people too. They might go. We dead anyway. We got to remember one thing. We own this land. Kennedy was assassinated. Do y'all really know why? It's deeper than that. He passed legislation under 1110 to bring the silver back to the United States, which would have automatically ended slavery. He said, watch this. He ain't gonna say it. When he passed that bill, you would have been able to go to your financial aid institute under the gold standard. They got anything you want. They said, we got to kill that crazy man. Took him out, and it was done by the Democratic Party. Did y'all know that? I used to be a Democrat up until last week. When I found out that they also killed Martin Luther King, LBJ had Martin Luther King assassinated in the Democratic Party. Y'all know how I know? Because they tried to assassinate me February 21st. The Ohio Democratic Party brought agents to my house to shoot me. And my sister said, Larry, you cost the Democratic Party $2.2 billion by defeating Fitzgerald last year. You better leave town. And you know, my sister is in Mississippi. She's an evangelist, and she had a vision. And I'm the only boy in the family. So my sister's like, get your ass to Mississippi. So I had to stop. I'm telling y'all. So on my way back, this is how I met Mariel. And we formed a group called SELG. I said, well, Jackie, time for me to go. I'm going to head back to Ohio. Then a woman called from Delta and said somebody's taking her house. So I stopped there and helped her. Then somebody said somebody in Georgia, his son locked up. I done got people out of jail in Georgia I ain't even seen them. I'm supposed to be in D.C. and Ohio right now. People call me on the phone. I'll send the parents of emotional and written habeas corpus. People call me all over. All right, brother, I'm out of jail. Where you at? I want to give you something. I set up these cases for appeal. When they see, when the judge see how the case is going, they're like, look, this one costs us $60,000, $70,000. Let this dude out of here. Let her out of here. Because if we get the judge on one assignment of error, you can win your case. You got to know what to file. When your attorney won't file your motion for you, you file it. Say, my lawyer is fired. We got black people sitting in prison all over the country. And it's going up. I just got arrested the other day. They wanted to see who I was. They arrested Mary out of the courthouse. They got surveillance going up, y'all. Have y'all seen the construction on the ground? They laying down surveillance. They're gonna be able to see you in an X-ray. Did y'all know that? They can look in your house. The military. Hillary Clinton just passed law for Virginia and West Virginia to have the army to occupy the prison system. It's the first time they're occupying it right now. The U.S. Army. Now who gonna stop them? Have y'all heard anybody mention that while they debate? They're like, we're gonna change things. We don't care about no $15 an hour minimum wage. We got over $22 trillion in reparations that ain't been paid. We ain't working for nobody else. We better take Alabama first. I told Mary, I'm coming back to Alabama. When I was driving through here, I seen a demon in this town. And it's that prosecutor, the DA.
Yeah.
And I told everybody, I'm going to drop the first lawsuit against Alabama, the state. And we did it yesterday. We call the devil out. Y'all dealing with more than what you think. Y'all dealing with a dark side here. Age-old racism that Martin Luther King went up against. Lincoln, Malcolm X found out the truth when he got back from Africa. He said, this ain't right. What's going on here? He was lying too. If you look at Martin Luther King's last tapes, he said, I'm not coming back from D.C. until we get the check. The check. They still got the check. Hold it. When I become U.S. president, each black family will get $1 million off the rip. Who will stop me? I ain't gonna see you. That's your money. I'ma show you in plain sight. I call it the general solicitor, though. David Morelli, though, up in D.C. hiding. Are they coming yet? They looking out the window. What to do with the check? You do something with it. White folks running. 10, 20,000 black folks coming for the check. Oh yeah, we gotta get a march together here. And we need volunteers for my campaign. This stuff gonna get ugly. Woo, because Hillary Clinton, I'm coming for you. I'm coming for Bush. See, this all started out between me, Clinton, and Bush. Everybody else jumped in there. Me and Clinton got a 25-year history. This been authorized by God for me and her to meet. She don't want none of this. I'm bringing the truth about who owns this land. Our forefathers won this in 1861. Lincoln signed it. I didn't sign it. Kennedy said, hey, give it to him today. What y'all talking about? He told Congress fat nasty to get out of here. Want to hear y'all bull crap? This thing, money. Look at it. They looking at it. We want to be able to control them. Now we're coming for the check. Is everybody ready for the check? All it takes is one signature from an executive officer.
is you gonna sign it, brother. You say you're black. Show the one piece of black that's in you and sign your name on that check. And then hand me the check. Let them come after me. You sign the run. Okay, Dolphin, Alabama. The police here is nuts, crazy. See, what happens when you lack melanin, you got problems. Haven't y'all seen the torture against black people? How do you think you're still here? Don't you know right here in this state, black people died on the cotton fields? Dead. With no relief, and they telling me, trying to talk to me? Washington, D.C.? Black people built Washington, D.C. And then they moved it out of the United States because Texas said, I'm going to blow you up. Texas! Anybody want to get with us before this is over? Or after it's over? Y'all got a civil case you need to get down that you're thinking about? Oh, God.
I do.
There is no statute of limitations. Don't let them fool you. If somebody owe you money, pull a claim against their property. Then they're going to call you. Oh, how you doing? I said you put a lien on my house. You want to take that off? Here's your $50,000. I'm sorry. And I want 15.5% interest in on the dollar. All right, well, y'all, my number 404-268-4925. I don't really chase in like insurance claims for houses and stuff, but 404-268-4925. We got an Atlanta and Douglasville, Georgia. What was that? Oh, Ely for president. Just go to Facebook. We on there. We finna get marijuana legalized in Ohio. We got the 500,000 votes, and the Senate then try to block me, but it ain't gonna work. Now I'm finna get marijuana legalized. I don't smoke though. So I started that push to get these brothers out of prison. Okay, well y'all, we gotta go. I said we got a few more speakers, I believe. But we gonna be at the door here with any other information that y'all need. It's time now to get your cases filed in federal court. Don't forget this. Federal court was erected in 1886 for black people only. That's black people's court. Don't forget that. If you got a state case pending down here, take your file over to federal court. And they're gonna say, uh-oh, here they come. Get the show ready. How many blacks out there in the lobby? About 3 or 4. They must have got assaulted by the police. Hold on, let's be ready. Woo-hoo. And they're gonna send a Jew out there. Maybe we help you? I got beat by police and I want to sue. Oh, they're like, oh God. Give them the form, get them a judge, a magistrate right now. So take your case to federal court from jaywalking to capital murder. And when they see you know that this is your court, you're going to get it done, man. I will talk to y'all later. Thanks, y'all.
I really appreciate you all coming. I don't want everyone to leave. We wanted to get the story. Anybody, especially anybody who had drugs playing on them? Okay, we have plates in the kitchen. Everybody, you can get a lunch for $10. Chicken plates are in the kitchen. If we want to take a break or a minute, or do y'all want to just go one at a time. We're selling these tickets like to help with the Karan Davis funding and also as a contribution. Hopefully we'll take a contribution for the church. Here's our reminder.
Janae. Thornton. Miss Thornton still here. Come on, let's go. Does anyone else have any forms that they want to submit to us?
I'm Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, he was that's my mother's sister. My mother, yeah. Miss Edge is my aunt.
You know her name, man. Yes.
I don't know.
Yeah, but he's a
little bit. Well, I'm not funny, but
I'm going to go to the hospital. Yeah, Because you don't want to cooperate with the DA. You've done this.
You should have never called the police to begin with. Stop doing that mess. That's, I have a problem with that. Baby, dad, baby, dad, I don't care. Leave them alone. But stop giving them people the right to kill your child. Maybe you want to speak up on it, or your boyfriend, or your man, or whatever. Then they ready to slap you down. You called them. Keep folks out your business. Why don't you go to church and let the counselor, the pastor, preach, pray for y'all or something? What you call the police for? Don't do that to our brothers. Don't do that. I believe
okay, nice to meet you. Me and her be like this ever since we were in fifth grade. We were killing. We running our mouth, being in front of the TV when Martin Luther King marches. Well, yeah, we were bad. My mom was like, "Girl, you so you don't have to run." But I didn't know that was the call that God had on my life to speak up for my people. Never knowing that my child would be a victim to the same kind of, you know, racism and being locked up 235 years. But it ain't coming again. And it's not going to, because I get mine when I'm in the same. And it's not going to stop until we stand up and start doing something about it. And like I said, going around here killing stuff and doing their job for them, y'all gotta get out of that. You gotta get out of that. And these, now these are just going to get in trouble. Oh my God, on there. And if you call me, I can give you a website, lock up the internet. I have a president. We got franchise, relationship, our own organization allowed to go to Houston, Texas, in the jail with Daniel Ryan. You got to know we're not leaving until that's the first. We're going to kill that. Yes, ma'am. Okay, yeah, that's her mom. Our father is
JJ. Yeah, something to do with
water? Yeah, I'm the president of the state of Alabama. We're nationwide now. We're based out of Atlanta. With your father, Gerald Rose Sr., is in Valhalla, Georgia. He was the one marching, it's not no just final organization. They got around.
What's the name?
Gerald Rose.
I knew a lot of those guys back in the old days. I was at Alabama State. So the 7 months.
Oh yeah, we did a formerly incarcerated people's movement 7 years ago across the Fettes Bridge. Yeah. That know we're gonna go back to the back of the bus. And I remember my cousin got fired on her job for being gone for 5 days, but we didn't care. And we just had different opportunities. Yeah, you just people get mad and want to do something they hate, but then they'll sit around and watch TV and the internet and see what's happening. And nobody want to do nothing. You can't see like that.
Well, we got. I think I'm hoping this is going to
consider. Yeah.
Because this community, I don't know what you're talking about. The government has really been quiet. All through the civil rights movement, even during the 60s, there's one of the few times on this side. Nothing. And it's my understanding Marvin Lee, Officer Kimball. And the black middle of the city. That's not, that's the story now. Yeah. Well, you know, it's about time.
And I'm getting ready to do a coalition of our job for all black ministers throughout the state of Alabama. I have 90 members.
I need to see
my pastor's wife, James Cole. And he called me.
What's James Cole?
New Brock and Shiloh. Gary, Dolores, Church, and Dallas.
Okay, bless you from
there. He's from the Brock. He's from the Elba area.
Okay,
right. No. The twins, Mary and Mark, would be in there probably saying, no, no, this is my. And he works out there at AFL. Can't get out there for years. This, we just spoke the other day, and I remember you said, the minister ran for, the minister ran for, you didn't really need a vote. The black minister, they had been laid down, and they changed the cap. I'm getting ready to do a man for me, I'm gonna make sure I can come for her. And you will see. Minister from all walks of life. It's gonna be after the first meeting. Yes, I'm sure I'll let y'all know how I feel. Yeah, I was thinking about that, but I had to have 21
years. You're gonna start the running. Now you gotta challenge the problem.
We all went to Germany together. You know, maybe we can. Christine is the one that called me on the
air.
No, I don't know.
Did you still say it?
Yeah, she did. And when I tell you,
no, it's a giant problem.
When he joined the church, my brother is a dad. Yeah, we didn't have to where the children's church was at now. That's what our church is. It wasn't for our children. I'm on the old. You got a chance of too much to get a
guy. Yeah. She don't have no room to talk
about.
I'm sure.